strategy for Knoxville-based advertising agency Design Sensory. He's the author of the blog advertisinganddisability.com and is a noted speaker and resource for journalists and industry leaders. Most recently, he has featured as an industry expert in New Mobility Magazine's cover story on advertising and disability. He spoke on the subject at the Forum of Workplace Inclusion alongside Singleton Dito, EVP of Viz4A. In 2016, he was elected to a three-year term on the City of Knoxville Mayor's Council on Disability Issue and served as the 2015 and 2016 District AAF District 7 Mosaic Chair. He's also a contributing author of a textbook on advertising and disability to be published in 2017 and teaches upper-level communication courses as an adjunct faculty here at King. He's partially blind and visually impaired, which gives him a unique perspective, and he's always clearly sees the best in everyone. Myself and some of the board members had the pleasure of seeing him speak at Tuscaloosa at the Fall Leadership Conference, and we really enjoyed him and thought that, you know, we wanted to bring him here and speak to you. So please join me in welcoming Josh.
Jenny, would it be possible to dim maybe these lights right here just a little bit? I'm going to talk about today is probably a conversation that's not had too often. I know the folks at Intera have this conversation probably more often than others, and in fact, Andy's going to be speaking about web accessibility coming up. So it's kind of interesting that there are almost back-to-back conversations about diversity, disability, and accessibility in advertising and the interactive space. So we're all in AAF, and one thing I'd ask of everybody is, what's missing from this logo? What words are missing, or word? The blank voice for advertising. Not the loudest.
Unifying.
So the unifying voice of advertising. If advertising is supposed to be so unifying, diversity and inclusion, of course, should be part of that, and that's hopefully what I can share a little bit more about today. How diversity and inclusion plays a significant part, or can better. So a little bit more about me. There's a couple of images here on this slide. The left is my birth certificate. I was born in 1973. Technology was, of course, not what it was, what it is now. And I was born 3 months premature, only weighed 2 pounds. The doctors told my parents to not name me. They said he's not going to make it. Well, my parents said, to heck with that, so they gave me the longest name they could. Joshua Bernard Zachary Loebner. And on the right side is a picture of me when I was almost 9 years old. I started to get pretty severe headaches as a young boy, and that's, you know, kids aren't supposed to get headaches. And I went to the doctor and the ophthalmologist and was misdiagnosed with pink eye. And it wasn't pink eye, it was actually glaucoma. And so I've had a glass eye, a prosthetic eye, since I was 9 years old. Not the same one, but I've got some stories there. So I have a blurred perspective. Every single person in this audience is blurry. It's very difficult for me to see clearly, even up close. So I love to be able to have close times with my family, the dinner table, or whatever, to see clearly. Everything in my life on a daily basis is blurry, but that gives me a singular perspective. What I saw when I first came into the industry was that diversity and inclusion was really not where it needs to be. And more specifically, with people with disabilities, back in the late 90s, early 2000s, there were only a few brands that even considered disability within the inclusion conversation. And today, that's still a challenge. That it's really one of the reasons or impetuses that I'm speaking. But the industry is recognizing some of the change. This is J. Walter Thompson produces the 100 trends every year. And in this one, I believe this was 2017's, they shared that in 2017, one of the top 100 trends within marketing and advertising would be disability inclusion. And I was fortunate enough to share some commentary there, but what I shared was, we're still not where we need to be within marketing and advertising. So I'm gonna set the stage a little bit. There are a few commercials that I'm gonna share later on in the presentation, but this one I wanna share because it's a little bit of an unveiling of a perspective on what people with disabilities can do. Throughout this, and throughout all my presentations, I don't try to just convey, hey, put people with disabilities in a commercial or in an image or some other asset within your marketing or advertising, but people with disabilities have opportunities to be talent within your workforce as well, or our workforce.
People think that having a disability is a barrier. But that's not the way I see it. You can catch up with friends.
Ready?
You can capture a moment with your family.
One face, small face, focus on.
And you can start the day bright and early. You can take a trip to somewhere new.
Racism, sexism, which are both still prevalent within our industry. There's also ableism, where we look down on people with disabilities, and used to, and hopefully not anymore. We used to look down on people would potentially look down on other races or other ethnicities or other religions. And I hope everyone in this room can agree that that just should never happen, that we are all equal as humans. But oftentimes, still, we see people who potentially can't walk, or can't see, or can't hear, or have other potential challenges, verbally or otherwise. And we look down on them from their capacity, either mentally from a learning perspective, or ultimately in our industry from a creative capacity. That woman cannot speak the way we speak, but she still has creativity in her mind and is able to share it. One thing to share about diversity and inclusion, I'll just take a quick step back here, is that diversity and inclusion is in the headlines every day. Charlottesville was just a horrendous incident, but whether we work with brands that are in destination marketing or brands like Tiki Torch here, who had no idea what was going to happen to them in the firestorm that their marketing team had to deal with. 20, 30 years ago, we were talking about features and benefits of a consumer packaged good, and that cut it. That was enough. But now, within the advertising industry, whether we're on the agency side or the advertiser side, we all have to make decisions to be able to recognize the position of our brand, not from brand positioning, but from social positioning within society. Where do we see our brand, and where is its place, and how does it fit? This next commercial doesn't specifically deal with disability either, but it also shows how diversity and inclusion is something that all of us within our industry, within communications is powerful. And this is a commercial from Procter & Gamble, and we'll take a second to watch it and talk through it a little bit later.
Who said that?
The lady at the store.
That is not a compliment.
Listen, it's an ugly, nasty word, and you are going to hear it. Nothing I can do about that. But you are not going to let that word hurt you. You hear me?
There are some people who think you don't deserve the same privileges just because of what you look like. It's not fair. It's not.
Remember, you can do anything they can. Difference is you gotta work twice as hard and be twice as smart.
Come straight from the practice. Your journey?
Is it something?
How's your review?
We're good.
You good?
Yeah.
You see?
We're good.
Okay.
Good.
Now, when you get pulled up,
I'm a good driver.
Okay. This is not about you getting a ticket. This is about you not coming home.
I'm gonna be okay. Right? Okay.
It's not fair. But you keep showing up.
You are not pretty for a black girl. You are beautiful, period. Okay? Don't ever forget that.
So I always like to bring up a funny fact. And Procter & Gamble film. Yeah, he's terrified. But the crazy thing about Procter & Gamble is they sell Swiffers. They sell mops, they sell Tide detergent and a number of other things, but they also sell something a bit more powerful than any one of those things, and it's the power of communications. Their team felt strongly enough that they recognized that they're not a products company, they're a people company. They help people succeed and get better in so many ways, but the other interesting thing that they recognized is that there are some people in our society that don't have it as easy as others when it comes to everything from grocery shopping to raising your family. So what they're saying is, let's take a bit of a stand as a brand and as a company and talk through these things. The other interesting point about that commercial is that it wasn't all historical. They showed historical notes of people with disabilities being discriminated against, but that discrimination hasn't changed. And again, with regards to diversity and inclusion, especially with people with disabilities, there's still a significant challenge there. But diversity and disability are kind of new. When I spoke at the Forum on Workplace Inclusion in Minneapolis, Minnesota, just a couple of years ago, even then they said, hey, we've not really had people talk about disability. But interestingly enough, disability, if we look at the numbers, is one of the largest minority groups in America. So people always ask, well, what is exactly a disability? The accessibility symbols in parking lots that show somebody in a wheelchair, I think we all can recognize maybe mobility is a disability, but there are so many others within the mix. Myself, I'm blind and have extremely low vision in my right eye is a disability. Movement or mobility, mental disabilities as well are there. Learning disabilities or cognitive disabilities, including autism, hearing disabilities, mental health, and again, so many others. This visual is from the Centers for Disease Control, sharing that 22% of adults in the U.S. have some type of disability. And when it's a percent, and I'll talk numbers in just a minute more, percentages kind of sort of make sense, but I'm going to bring it back down to the impact here in Tennessee. More specifically, though, here in the Southeast, the percentage of people living with disabilities in each state is highest in the Southeast. I've been fortunate to share conversations about disability to the 4As up in New York, and that was wonderful. That was great. but I've also been fortunate to speak to a number of different clubs here in the Southeast in District 7. And for me, that's more impactful specifically because of this number and because of this data here, seeing that more people in the Southeast have disabilities than any other. So if that's the case, shouldn't we in the marketing and communications industry recognize in some way, shape, or form, how can we be inclusive or considerate of people with disabilities in whatever we're doing, marketing, advertising, a digital presence? 1 in 5 Americans has a disability. These are the percentages translated into more maybe understandable numbers. So if 1 in 5 Americans has it, that's over 50 million people in America have some type of disability. 1 in 4 women has a disability. 3 in 10 people of color have disabilities. And then if we take it a step further and look at here in Tennessee, 15.6 of individuals in Tennessee have some type of disability. In 2015, over 1 million people had a disability in our state. So a state that's almost 7 million, over 1 million people have a disability. Lots of times we don't see people with disability in advertising or marketing or communication, so we think, well, it's a small audience. It's really insignificant. There's no reason for me to incorporate somebody with a disability because it doesn't matter. They're not prevalent in our society. But they are prevalent. According to Tennessee state records, what we're seeing is, from a financial standpoint, earnings with a disability are $34,400. Earnings without a disability are $40,000 on average annually. And so, again, well, some people had this potential initial thought that there's not a lot of people with disabilities. Well, actually, there are. And then secondly, people might say, well, if even though there are a lot of people with disabilities here in Tennessee, they don't have money. They're in institutions, they're hospitalized, they're living in the basement of their parents' house. But what we're seeing is, in fact, just the opposite. Of these million people, there are a substantial number of them that make almost as much as other people here in our state that have the spending power of anyone. And when it comes to spending power, we also have to recognize that those people with disabilities are just as brand loyal. Just because I have one eye doesn't mean I'm less brand loyal than if I had two eyes, and it'd be the same as somebody with no legs or couldn't hear. That brand loyalty doesn't change amongst humans. We all have affinity for certain brands and not. And the dollar amounts get even more significant when families and friends are involved. It goes upwards into the billions and trillions of dollars that these people have to spend. And as advertisers, we always want to make sure we're connecting with people who make decisions with their wallets, and people with disabilities do. So our industry connects with pop culture. It's synonymous with what's going on in the zeitgeist of the world. In the Rio Olympics in 2016, disability was at the forefront, and a number of advertisers and marketers, and we'll talk about those, connected with the disability community, and here with the Winter Olympics coming up, it's the same as well. There's a good thing and a bad thing about that. We'll talk about that in a second. Peter Dinklage, I've got the Super Bowl commercial. We're going to watch it and talk through the positives of that. Dancing with the Stars, Nico DeMarco, he won and he was totally deaf. Speechless is in, I think it's third season on ABC, featuring a young man who has mobility and speech issues. This is interesting in that media coverage of disability. Campaign Magazine asked a question just about 2 years ago. They said, why are people with disabilities invisible in advertising? And if you go and read into the article, nobody had an answer. There was no credible point to say that, well, here's why we shouldn't advertise to people with disabilities, or here's why we shouldn't bring people with disabilities into our brainstorming sessions at ad agencies, or incorporating them into focus groups, or putting them in our advertising alongside somebody else who is fully able. There was no answer. And so our industry is asking those questions. There are some bad things, of course, that happen with this disability. One of them, predominantly, that ties back to our industry, or a little bit more so in the entertainment side, is that Rarely, if ever, if a movie features prominently somebody with a disability, is the actor portraying that individual disabled? And a lot of folks, I would agree, I would say that that's pretty much tantamount to blackface. Let's get a white person, paint their face black, and they can pretend to be a black person in the movie. It's just something that shouldn't happen, you know. Some people say, well, there's not a lot of actors who have disabilities, but the Screen Actors Guild would share with you that there are in the thousands of people who are double leg amputees, single leg amputees, blind, fully blind people, hard of hearing people, people in wheelchairs, that are able to play roles, autistic. And there have been some that have made some ground, but when you have Alec Baldwin playing a blind person, for me that just doesn't make sense. These two individuals here were promoting the Rio Olympics in Brazil's version of Vogue magazine, and neither one of these people here in this image has, this man is a single leg amputee and she is an amputee above the elbow. They were not people with disabilities. They were fully able actors in Brazilian telenovela soap operas, and the magazine just decided to kind of airbrush out there or Photoshop their arms. Why should a magazine editor think that that's appropriate, but also be uncomfortable with maybe changing the color of somebody's skin? So for the folks at Intera, I'm sure you guys are well aware of this, and this is something probably that Andy's going to speak about coming up, but just this past June, Winn-Dixie went to court with a blind individual. He was suing because he couldn't access their website. It wasn't ADA compliant, and Winn-Dixie has to spend roughly, or at least within the court filings, $250,000 to make a change to their website. Now, ADA compliance does not take $250,000, especially if you move for it in the beginning of your planning, and it's something that our agency that I work with, Design Sensory, make sure all of our websites are ADA compliant. But it's something that maybe your clients don't have $1 million advertising budgets to be on television, and so these commercials that I'm about to show you might say, well, whatever, our clients don't have the budget for that, so sure, that's great. If we had the budget, we'd incorporate somebody with a disability. But every single one of our clients, or if you're on the advertiser side, everybody has websites. And so it's an opportunity for all of us to consider in a small way, but also in a significant way, how we all can make sure that our digital connections are inclusive. So the commercials that I'm going to share coming up talk about disability in a certain way, each of them, some for the better, some for the worse. And there's this interesting pendulum when it comes to incorporating people with disabilities. On one extreme, which is not good, there's this pity factor, where people with disabilities are one of the few minority groups that creatives and advertisers still feel okay to put in a commercial and share pity for. But then I would ask, well, would we put a person of color in a commercial and try to play the pity factor for them? Or a lesbian, or a gay person, or a Hispanic, or an Asian? Would we put them in a commercial and try to make them look pitiful? And if we don't for them, why should we with people with disabilities? I'm a very happy man with one eye and that I can hardly see. And I know a lot of people who have been in wheelchairs for their whole life and who have hearing issues or other challenges, and they're comfortable with those. It's a part of their life and they're happy. So the pity factor is something we definitely don't want. But then there's also inspiration. Now, we're all about making everyday things sensational in advertising and marketing and to inspire. But there's this weird kind of inspiration that connects back to ableism. And ableism is when you're an able-bodied person and you look at somebody with a disability and you say, gosh, I'm glad I'm not where they are. And I feel better about myself because I'm not them. Now, I hope none of us say that about a person of color or any other minority. But again, people with disabilities, able-bodied people can get inspired and we call that inspiration porn. There's it's an empty inspiration that really shouldn't be there. Ultimately, down in the middle of the pendulum is exactly where people with disability want in marketing and advertising. And that's just inclusion. I'm married to a wife who's able, my kids are able-bodied, and it doesn't make me any lesser of a man or more. And the same with my work. I'm one of the few, if only, persons with disability at my office, but it doesn't make me better or worse. I'm just included with everybody else. And that's what we want with that within advertising and marketing. So I'm going to run through a couple of examples and talk through these. This first one, if you guys watched the Super Bowl, you probably saw this one. Some bad points about it, and I'll talk about those in a second. Toyota is doing some amazing things. Toyota has created a whole website about specifically mobility and how they're trying to ensure that there can be just everybody is on equal ground when it comes to mobility, and they're making significant strides well outside of the confines of automobile manufacture to be able to ensure that people in wheelchairs and other people with mobility issues have opportunities that they haven't had previously. So definitely kudos to them. The challenge with this commercial, and it's a badass commercial, the challenge with this commercial is that advertisers always think, hey, those Paralympics are coming around. Let's put somebody with a disability in our commercial and show that we are inclusive. But I can guarantee you that those brands, advertisers, and agencies are brainstorming about campaigns well beyond the confines of Paralympics. During the remainder of the 4 years, you know, that there isn't a sporting event and people with disability aren't being thrown out in brainstorming sessions and ideating sessions. It's only in certain instances where we can say, hey, let's put in this minority. But do we say that with black people? Do we say that with Hispanics? Do we say that with any other minority group? We don't. So again, inclusion doesn't have to be just every 4 years. This is another athletic commercial.
Here is a man working hard, pushing his limits. You got this?
I got this.
Cool, you got this. Wait, what? You don't have arms.
But
you don't have legs either.
Oh, really? I must have left them at home.
You left them at, dude, that's not hard. You're on top of a mountain. It's dangerous.
So what I'd say about that commercial, there's humor in it, and it was part of a larger narrative that Nike put together that included the number of different individuals of varying abilities and a number of different athletes. Again, it's very athlete-driven, and there's a term within the disability community called super crips, where communicators, advertising agencies, marketers, advertisers only feature athletes when it comes to people with disabilities. That it puts on this aura of, well, if you're a disabled person, you probably are in the Paralympics, right? No. There are a lot of disabled people that aren't in the Paralympics. They're just regular people. There are a lot of black people that don't play in the NFL. And so there are certain stereotypes that continue to linger with this minority that we've moved past with other minority groups. And the other challenge with this one is somebody on the creative side thought it would be great to feature somebody with a disability and call them out for it as they're climbing a mountain. Would we do that with a and we show a tight shot of a person climbing a mountain, and you just see their, you know, their winter gear, and you don't really see who they are. And then at the top, we would say, "Hey, that's a lesbian. She climbed a mountain." I don't think we would. I think somebody would look and say, "Josh, what the hell were you drinking before this training session?" But still, somehow, people with disabilities, let's throw them in. It's okay. It's not okay. So now we're going to talk about some positive ads. And I hate to say it, but this ad is a couple of years old. There just aren't a lot of people with disability incorporated in advertising as often as I and other people would like to see. This is from HoneyMade, and this was originally with the Droga5 agency. The clients moved on from there, but they initially came up with the concept of what is wholesome. And the campaign, of course, is much more extensive than just this one commercial incorporating Islamic Americans, incorporating biracial families, and incorporating the LGBT community. But let's watch this commercial, and I'll share a few reasons why this is a very positive spot.
While you were deployed, I was wondering if I would ever get to see you again, if I would get to tell you that I loved you. But we got a second chance. When you returned, just watching you guys bond again is a beautiful thing. I love the fact that whatever has been thrown our way, we've been able to get through together.
HoneyMade, this is wholesome.
So that was an awesome commercial. It was actually double diversity. It was a person of color who also is a person with a disability, which is relatively rare in advertising and marketing. Oftentimes there's whitewashing with disability in that brands don't want to incorporate two diversities within an actor or talent or whomever is on screen, either in a static ad or a commercial. So this was great. And you don't have to have legs to like graham crackers. Like, he's a dad. He's not a super athlete. He's just a dad who loves his kids, who loves graham crackers. And, oh, by the way, he's missing legs. So that's good. It's inclusion. It didn't show him, it didn't show this person with a disability by themselves climbing some mountain. It showed somebody with a disability in an everyday situation. And that is significant from a social inclusion standpoint, so that for us who might not interact with somebody with a disability on a regular basis, it shows that they're just like us. And then if we do bump into somebody, we're not gonna say, "Hey, are you in the Paralympics? Are you an athlete?" It just allows for more indoctrination of recognition of positives of people with disabilities, instead of putting them on some weird pedestal. They're just like you and I. They might just have a few different abilities than us.
While you were
so this next commercial is from the Super Bowl. I'm sure everybody saw it.
Flavor that brings the heat.
Awesome, and he is a little person. That's the correct terminology to utilize, is little person. And he doesn't care. He doesn't let his disability get in front of him. And really, that's, you know, people with disability are people, and that terminology, people with disability, people comes first. people of color. We are all humans, and Peter Dinklage does such a wonderful job just sharing who he is and not having to somehow just look at him because of his disability. This next commercial got a lot of national and international press. It's from Maltesers, which is a British company. And again, this is just a, there's a bit of humor in it.
So, your boyfriend.
Okay.
And we are back at his, getting a little
first game. My hands may have been wandering, starting.
Go on.
Then I start having a spasm.
No. Which he misinterprets.
So awkward.
He was a good lady.
Feels so bad, so what he said.
So the great part about this one is that we weren't laughing at her, we were laughing with her. So we weren't looking down on this person with a disability. The other interesting thing is that people with disabilities are oftentimes, from an ableist perspective, looked down upon, like not only that they're a lesser person, but they're looked at from a childlike perspective, no matter their age, and that individual who is disabled but an adult shouldn't have a relationship, shouldn't have an adult relationship, but in fact, that's just the opposite. There have been a lot of articles of late in the New York Times and other publications about how people with disabilities are being included more in storylines and narratives in entertainment to showcase that people with disabilities are adults and they do adult things. So this was a great commercial that, again, it didn't look down on that person with a disability. It showed that they were just like one of us. They love people. They have relationships. They have fun. So when it comes to advertising and students who are coming up into our industry, students learn skills. They learn to code. They learn to design. They learn to be account managers, hopefully. I teach media strategy at University of Tennessee, and I also teach communications at King University. Neither one of those classes nor programs really incorporate diversity in a capacity, and really no university does currently, with regards to including, making sure that students recognize the value of including minority groups within conversations of creative concepting and developing and programming. We are just now starting to have those conversations. This was a gentleman with his master's degree. He was a graphic designer, and he was earning his master's degree, and his thesis was on where are all the disabled people. So mirroring that headline that we saw earlier in the slide presentation from Campaign Magazine, why are the people with disabilities invisible? And I'm trying to continue that. I'm also earning a PhD at Clemson University, and my focus is on advertising and greater inclusion of people with disabilities. This is a talent recruitment survey that the 4A's did, saying that 74% of 4A members surveyed feel that agencies are either mediocre or worse when it comes to hiring diverse groups of employees. When I was fortunate enough to speak with the 4A's, Nancy Hill at the time was president, Singleton Beato was EVP of talent recruitment. Both of them wholeheartedly shared that our industry is still racist, just not as much as it used to be. Still sexist, just not as much as it used to be. And definitely still ableist. So the one consideration here is that while this presentation does talk a lot about inclusion from a television talent standpoint, or being able to have a website that is digitally inclusive, there's also just hiring people who are account managers, hiring people with disabilities who can play any capacity within our industry, that's something that's still a challenge. And not only that, is that once we hire people who potentially might be diverse from any minority group, there's a lot of heads butting. But there are changes. I've been fortunate to work with a group called Lights, Camera, Access 2.0, and it's a group that helps to foster more inclusion, both at the professional level, but also to recruit young talent into the industry. And we've had opportunities to speak everywhere from CBS News in Los Angeles, California, to various agencies in New York. It's going to be in Chicago this summer, and a couple of Decembers ago, we had it at the White House. It was not within this administration. So here are just a few final thoughts to talk through. Start conversations. I hope that you didn't just come to this for a little bit of a lunch and some networking. Hopefully you came, and hopefully within my presentation, you're able to get just a little bit more insight. It's been wonderful. I was in Montgomery, Alabama, speaking to the AAF chapter there, and several of the people in the audience were with the Southern Poverty Law Center. And one of the things that they shared with me right after the presentation was, you know what? We have a lot of minority conversations on our website, predominantly those from a religious standpoint and a racial standpoint, but disability isn't featured as prominently as it should be. So that was definitely a positive that warmed my heart. Welcome recruitment. One interesting thing to say about Upper East Tennessee is I grew up in Hancock County, and being blind and visually impaired, I was fortunate enough to have some support from the state for my college tuition, and a vocational rehabilitation office was here nearby in Johnson City, just on Buffalo Street. Joyce Bromley was my vocational rehabilitation counselor, and she helped me learn different ways to be able to write, to read textbooks, and to be productive in my collegiate career. And so I'm thankful that vocational rehabilitation here in Johnson City helped me, but I know it can help so many others, that there are people of any diverse background here that would love to be able to be part of this industry, and hopefully this chapter and where you work can welcome them to be inclusive of people with disabilities. And not only inclusive of people with disabilities potentially in work, but if you conduct focus groups, if you conduct any research, to try to be considerate of, well, what would somebody with a disability have to say about this, that, or the other? That if you do want to incorporate disability into your marketing and advertising, or your online platforms, to make sure that audience is part of the conversations. Be open to including people with disabilities in creative. Ultimately, recognize that people with disabilities are part of clients' customer mix, and they have money in their wallet to spend. I say this in all my presentations, that I believe that leadership is about perspective, and that advertising is powerful. It truly is powerful. Advertising can elect presidents. It can create change in society, and we all have to realize that there is an opportunity for us within that mix to do something powerful. And just to share, what is your perspective? This last slide here, in life we lose things. Sometimes we lose our keys, sometimes we lose our temper, sometimes we lose hours of sleep on a project. Me, I'm losing my sight. Every year my sight gets worse, and ultimately I'm not going to be able to see these people ever again. But I found something a little bit more powerful, and it's the memory that I'll have of them, of their, you know, how they look. But beyond that, I found an opportunity to be hopefully productive in the industry, to make some changes, to get people excited about something maybe that they hadn't considered before they came to a luncheon. So I'd ask of you, what are things maybe that you've lost in your life, but also what are some things that you found and that you can move forward with and that you can hopefully be an advocate for, either in your professional life or your personal life with your family? So thank you for your time this afternoon, and any questions, comments? So the backstory on that is that well before the Super Bowl evening, Dodge reached out to the Martin Luther King family. And the Martin Luther King family said yes. This is something that they wanted to be a part of. So the challenge sometimes is that we don't help to set the stage and set the story of something that might be a bit divisive or cause at least conversation. So Dodge could have done a little bit of a better job, and maybe they did, and it just got overlooked. But Dodge should have done a little bit better job to set the story about that, or maybe provided a microsite where people could learn a little bit more about that. Martin Luther King's family said, yes, this is wonderful, let's do this. But yet it got a lot of negative publicity, and a lot of people shared that, well, this is just, why would they tie that to, why would they tie Martin Luther King's legacy to this brand? So I can understand both sides of the story. I think Dodge could have done a better job in maybe teeing up what they were about to do.
So we met at the District 7, so thanks again, Josh, for coming. So I work at Intara, and one of the things that we talk to our clients about a lot is web accessibility, why it's important, the legal ramifications of it. But a lot of times the conversation doesn't go back to, you should do it because it's the right thing to do. They have the conversation of, well, how much is this going to cost?
Right.
And I think part of the challenge is when you are kind of explaining to stakeholders at an organization the different tiers of accessibility on a website, do you think it's unnecessarily complicated? I mean, when we try to tell our customers, well, this is accessible and this isn't, and you can't write your content that way because it's not accessible, and having the dialogue is really, really difficult for us, and I think our clients are not understanding, and we're trying to do a better job of educating, but I don't feel like the federal government is doing a good job of making
well,
it easier.
Well, not right now, of course.
Yeah. So I guess my question to you would be, you know, how do you continue to have the conversation with clients, with stakeholders? What are the important things to hit on? What level of accessibility do you appreciate when you visit a website? That type of thing.
So there isn't a lot of support from the federal government right now. These are not mandated regulations. They're, to an extent, ones, they're guidelines. They potentially could be mandated, and if they are mandated, over 90% of websites currently today are not ADA compliant, so that would be a significant hurdle that would need to be overcome. But I think we all, well, I'm old enough, some of you here in this audience might not be old enough to remember before your clients needed to have websites. There was a significant educational hurdle back in the late 90s to try to get clients to see the value of spending tens of thousands of dollars on a website. And ultimately, within new mediums that are introduced regularly. We can look at social media more recently, or even a variety of social media platforms. You know, clients might say, why should I advertise on Snapchat? Why should I invest to have an individual at the ad agency or on my team be in social media all day? I don't see the value of it. But it's all about educating. Some people are going to buy into it, and others aren't. I'll give you an interesting story on ADA compliance and website accessibility. The state of Tennessee, of course, has tnvacation.com. That is not our website at Design Century, while at one time it was over our purvey. But I still receive a lot of the email marketing, and I received an email for a contest that was going to be in Cumberland Caverns, here Jack White and some other people, in a concert in Cumberland Caverns. And that's what the text said on the landing page on tnvacation.com. And at the very bottom it said, this is not... this contest is not available for handicapped people. So, number one, just to share a little bit more knowledge with everyone here. Sometimes I even slip up and say the word handicapped, but I definitely try not to. We don't call people of color Negroes anymore. The word handicapped comes from people with disabilities not being able to hold any job. And it was about when they were beggars and they held their cap in their hand asking for money. So it's a very derogatory term. So I reached out to the state and I said, I sent a note actually to the commissioner, and I said, you guys need to, and their director of communications said, you guys need to change this. And I shared the reasons why, and they said, okay. And then they changed it and said, this contest is not accessible, or is not offered to people with disabilities. And I said, well, wait a second, that didn't solve the problem. There are over 1 million people in our state that have a disability. And you eliminating those and all the other potential tourists in America from this contest is a pretty slanderous thing, and it shows that you're not inclusive to all minority groups. Well, then their lawyer called and said, we'll make this change in a couple of hours. And so they changed the website content to share that while this venue is not accessible for people with disabilities, we will provide alternate opportunities for this contest for people with disabilities. I said, thank you, that's great. So there's a hurdle not only from a technological standpoint with regards to ADA compliance online, but also from a content perspective. There are multiple layers of entry with accessibility online, and it's just a narrative that has to keep on keeping on. And looking at those clients that potentially, whether it's universities or financial institutions or others within the public space that might need to be more ADA compliant than others, and start those conversations with them and start to have victories with them that potentially can then lead into other groups. And it's also about finding advocates on the client side. And usually those advocates who are wanting to include people with disabilities, potentially maybe it's a CEO that has a wife or a family member or a friend or themselves have a disability. So it's something that's not going to change overnight. It's something that our agency faces as well in making those changes. Yes.
I have a question. It may not totally speak to disability, maybe a little bit more diversity, but when you had pointed out, like, you would never point out that a lesbian climbed a mountain. I noticed more and more advertising and marketing saying, like, well, a woman did this. But what is your perspective on that and your pendulum of advertising?
The one thing I'll say to that is that brands tend to go towards where the money is. And there are a lot of very influential organizations that do focus on women. And I'm not in any way saying that brands shouldn't integrate and connect with and promote positivity with regards to women. But again, it's all about where brands and advertisers think that potentially there's money. And so oftentimes the disability community is not incorporated into advertising because oftentimes advertisers don't think that there are dollars there. But I wholeheartedly champion more women in advertising in a very positive light. I think we all know about the very derogatory Hardee's commercials, which now, thank goodness, they've changed to focus more on the food. But our industry still is horribly sexist. Interestingly enough, with regards to women in advertising, Britain, so we of course have AAF here and the 4As, that are governing bodies for our industry in America. Britain's, I believe it's acronym is the IAC, I couldn't tell you what that stands for, but Britain's governing advertising body has made it illegal for agencies in any way to have sexist advertising. And all networks in Britain know that they have the right to not show advertising that they deem sexist in any way. So America, while it is making strides and being more inclusive for women as a group in advertising, is nowhere near certain other countries. Did that answer your question? Any other questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
And I'm not quite sure how to ask it.
Okay.
What are your thoughts on companies who focus on a lot of aspirational advertising that may not necessarily align with their corporate brand? So GE comes to mind first and foremost. Amazing advertising campaigns, love them.
Yeah.
Very heartfelt, very, you know, aspirational. If you know anything about GE's culture as an operating company, very, very different. And so from a brand reputation perspective, just curious if you have any insight on that.
You're saying their altruistic advertising is incongruous with their culture, is that right?
Right.
It can't start at the communications. It has to start with culture. Otherwise, it's a thin veneer that's an eggshell that's going to crack, that you know, either as an employee there or somebody who's connected with communications in some other way, that it's just not true, that it's incongruous. It has to start with culture, and it has to start at the top. You have to have buy-in at the C-suite level to be able to recognize value of inclusion and diversity. It's not just one department. It's not just the HR department that needs to champion diversity and inclusion. It's all managers, and ultimately, it's at that C-level that needs to be an advocate to show that top down, we have buy-in, and then you can start to espouse the value and the validity of greater inclusion, greater diversity within your communication. So that's what I would share, is that buy-in starts internally.
I've heard you give this speech a number of times. Something you didn't say this time that always strikes me too. You know what I'm going to say.
Oh, then I'll say it. Thank you, Sarah. Now, the interesting thing about this conversation is that I will personally welcome anybody in this room to join my minority group. You might trip down the stairs going out and have a challenge from a physical mobility standpoint. You might eventually age just a little bit more and have macular degeneration. But recognize that every single person in this room, as you get older, you're going to get disabilities. There may be other minority groups potentially that you could join, but this is one of the few that really we will all be a part of. And so if every single one of us here, right now, you might be in perfect health, but eventually you're going to have a disability. If we all are going to have a disability, shouldn't we right now think about how we can incorporate that inclusion within our marketing and advertising? Thank you for that.
I think that's a great place to end. Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Dr. And
just a reminder, the advertising awards are on the 17th. Get your tickets. Thanks for coming.